I'm hearing that, like, you know, we're beginning to loosen up restrictions around the world. I think that's really excited. I'm personally excited for the cast of Chucky. I watched the first season recently. It was very good. I'm hoping they get to have a big premiere for the second season because everybody loves to get dolled up.
Ooh, nice. So, Darren, I don't know if you saw the news lately, but Dwayne Johnson is going to star in another game movie, preferably this time with paper and scissors.
Nice.
Hey there, Internet. My name is Jack Packard, 5.1 surround sound here for The Escapist.
And I'm Darren Mooney, the Tingler, but we had to take that out after several people had heart attacks and there was a lawsuit.
The weirdest part was several people wanting, like, the compliments that you got, the several people who just wanted to work with you more. Not going to say who, but he wears a baseball cap often. First off, Darren and I are going to talk Peacemaker, the spinoff to the spinoff to the sequel of the DC Extended Universe. And then later, Marty and KC are going full weeb shit to talk Attack on Titan, which is an anime. I saw the first season. I thought it was very cool. It's big, you know, big monsters and guys with swords that swing around like Spider-Man. But I don't care about anime weeb shit that much. So we're gonna hand it off to them.
You really are a titan in the field of anime criticism.
Okay. So hello and welcome. This is your feature presentation. So. Peacemaker, which is a spin-off HBO Max series from James Gunn's Suicide Squad, following John Cena as the titular Peacemaker on another mission. Here's how I would like to start. Do you tell me this, because I have never been to Ireland, or, you know, most of Europe for that matter. Do you have their, like, greasy diners? Like the 24-hour, you know, serves breakfast all day long. The food isn't great, but at 2 a.m, it's just what you need.
I sense a theme and possible conclusion coming to that argument. Mm-hmm. The short answer is yes, we have ripoffs of American diners, and we pay a premium for them, which is fantastic. That was the Eddie Rockets is our equivalent, because it's very much meant to be a 50s American diner, and it's fast food at real food prices is what we call it here in Ireland, as well as empty pockets instead of Eddie Rockets, because we use Cockney rhyming slang too.
You know, here in the States, we're littered with them. Here in Milwaukee, where I am, we have a wonderful place called George Webb's. And yeah, it's open 24 hours. You can have scrambled eggs and hamburgers in the same meal. It's cheap, it's greasy, it's buttery, and it's always what you want, but never what you need. And that is my feeling about James Gunn as a director. And I say this with a lot of love, by the way, because I love greasy diner food. And I think that James Gunn would take this as a compliment, that he is the greasy diner of directors. So it's like Peacemaker falls into that weird category of, like, oh, this is kind of sloppy. It's not great, but there is something that I love about it.
That's interesting, because I almost had the exact opposite response to it, where this is greasy. It is probably not good for you. It is very high in fat. But I do actually, like, one of the things that I find really interesting about Gunn as a director is that, and a writer, because he does write a lot of his own projects. In fact, he actually wrote all of this. I think he directs 5 of the 8 episodes in total. But, like, as a writer and director, I find myself drawn to Gunn as somebody who looks very poppy, looks very casual, looks very fun, looks very silly, looks very goofy. But underneath his work, there is always something interesting going on.
Sure.
And there's always something, you know, maybe it's related to modern masculinity, maybe it's related to 80s retro nostalgia, maybe it's as simple as, man, dads, am I right? But there is a sense in his work that he is using, like, pop cinema in a way that is not pretentious, is not precious, that is not condescending, that doesn't take itself too seriously, but is still kind of saying things that are important and do emotionally matter and resonate. So, like, I look at Peacemaker and it is very goofy, it's very silly. In fact, it has I would argue a lot of the problems that you identified with guns work when we talked about the Suicide Squad, which is the idea of characters who just joke for the sake of joking. Mm-hmm. But underneath all that, I do think that there is something I find strangely affecting and moving and kind of vaguely like relevant in what he's doing in a way that I don't necessarily connect with some of the other stuff we covered. I mean, I think I talked about when we talked about Hawkeye. I have no idea what Hawkeye is actually about.
Sure.
In like a vague existential philosophical sense. I know it's about, what, 6 episodes long instead of Christmas, but I don't know what it's saying about the world in which we live and the characters and anything like that. I just know that it's a fun, goofy adventure. Whereas I look at this and I go, this is saying something about the way in which we train people to kill. It's saying something about what we look in terms of heroism. It's saying something about dysfunctional relationships that men have with their fathers. It's saying something about the way in which we accept violence if it's done by the state. And all that stuff is kind of interesting and fun, but it also has dick jokes. And I like dick jokes, too.
And I can agree with that sentiment wholly. I would argue Hawkeye is not saying anything. It's pure popcorn,
and which fine.
Is also
that,
fine.
That's fine,
which
is fine. Not.
Oh, yeah. No, and that's what, like, the mixed bag of James Gunn to me is that. Is, like, he does wear his heart on his sleeve in his projects, in his written and directorial projects. And I applaud that. I always think his execution is a little fumbly. Even once we get to the 4th episode, which is directed by this name right here, which I can't remember right now, I feel like the story starts to coalesce more just because he's able to collaborate and hand off some of the responsibilities to someone who has maybe a clearer vision. There's just one segment that I need to expound upon as far as, like, it is a perfect highlight of my issue with James Gunn in general and my issues with Peacemaker overall, which is in the 1st episode. So, you know, it's not really spoiler, it's episode 1. There is a gag in which Peacemaker joins his new Suicide Squad-esque handlers at a diner. And the big joke is that he comes in full Peacemaker costume and looks very ridiculous. The epic fumbling of that punchline is something that should be studied, because this is a still image that I have provided to Omar that is a scene of them, a shot of them all sitting at the booth. John Cena looks ridiculous in his full outfit. That shot is the punchline. He looks ridiculous. He is out of place in a situation that is very normal. But the way the scene plays out, James Gunn has a way of not delivering a punchline, but delivering a slowly pushing forward line. The characters repeat often that he looks ridiculous.
Did this dipshit really show up in full cosplay mode?
Is that an eagle in his back seat?
Why are you in your costume?
A bright red shirt and white pants aren't exactly conducive to lurking in the shadows.
Why is there a bald eagle in your car?
We have 3 solid minutes of pushing forward this punchline that he looks very weird when all we needed was the contrast of him and the normal looking folks in the booth. We don't get a punchline. We get this ramble, you know?
I would recognize that, and I think that's a fair point. I do think, though, that what Gunn does is he sacrifices the easy punchline of, gee, it's a superhero in a regular day situation, which is like a very, you know, Family Guy cutaway joke, for something that I think builds throughout the first couple of episodes, which is this idea that it's not so much just about Peacemaker, but it's about how everybody sees Peacemaker and the gulf between how he sees himself and how they see him. So you have this conversation, and it happens throughout the episodes, of like how the various different team members kind of see Peacemaker. So you have Harcourt, who sees him as just another handsome jackass. You have, for example, the character Murn, who sees him as somebody he can emotionally leverage or exploit. You have Leota, who sees him as somebody who is fundamentally broken and sad. And you get all of that in that scene. And it all builds, I think, to not a joke punchline, but a surprisingly effective emotional payoff, I think, in the 2nd episode, where Peacemaker goes home to his bed in his, by the way, I love this, in his Pacemaker mobile home. and lies in bed and cries and slaps himself while acknowledging that everybody thinks he's a fucking joke.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a moment that I find weirdly effective and kind of moving for all the silly, goofy, bantery stuff that the episode or the show kind of does. I think like that for me is what I love about the show, is that the character is fundamentally ridiculous. The character looks fundamentally ridiculous, even compared to like his teammates in the Suicide Squad, compared to Bloodsport or Ratcatcher, or leave aside Polka Dot Man for a moment. He looks absurd. He looks like this kind of like bright, you know, 2D character from the 60s, which he is, brought to life with his bright primary colors. And instead he becomes this really sad, vulnerable character. Like in that first episode, the pre-teaser, the pre-credit sequence, and we may talk about the credit sequence in a moment, but the sequence of like John Cena, who is this like bodybuilder, former wrestler, like 80s action hero, Stallone, Schwarzenegger body type.
Mm-hmm.
Tiptoeing out of the hospital as if he's afraid somebody with a clipboard is going to say, sir, you're not supposed to be there. The fact that like so much of the show is him in his underwear, like the climax of the first episode is him in his tidy whities singing into a vibrator. It's a funny image, but it's also something that is weirdly vulnerable and kind of, you know, creates this emotional sensitivity towards him. And I think like this is a really long, rambly way of me defending your very astute point about the mishandling of a joke. But that's the fact that it takes the 3 minutes of him pulling up in the car, him getting out wearing the uniform, everybody in the restaurant seeing him get out, and him not just suddenly like miraculously appearing like Batman in a quick cut, kind of makes it more sad and more pathetic, and for me, more emotionally resonant, because you see, like, he's a 12-year-old kid who thinks that this is cool, and by not getting straight to the joke, you instead get the sadness of, it's something like I think you should leave sketch, where it's about the building social awkwardness of, no, he's coming, he's wearing the uniform, he's walking slowly towards us, it's gonna happen, and there's no way we can avoid it. And that's what I respond to, I think.
I think that's a fair counter argument. I think that there is a way to have our cake and eat it too here, where we could still get the joke, we could still get the juxtaposition, and then the fallout of that is all of that gooey character stuff that you're talking about. Because once we start praising the show, it will be all of that, just gooey characterization, wonderfully weird moments. John Cena, every other actor needs to be envious of John Cena's ability to commit and make himself look ridiculous in a straight face. That man is a national treasure, and I will hear no other opinions of John Cena.
The first day of shooting was him in his underwear singing into a vibrator, which is incredible to me. Like, that's how you start working with John Cena on this show. I love it.
No, and I mean, like, I don't watch wrestling. I'm not a wrestling fan, never really have been. So I know nothing of his career or his, you know, him as a performer in that realm. I only know him as a comedy actor. And like you said, he is a caricature of a man. He is muscle and jawline. And the way he is able to play his role so seriously, it brings me so much joy. Every time he does anything on screen, I am in awe of him as a character actor.
Like, when they announced Peacemaker as the spin-off project from the Suicide Squad, I was like, what? Why is that guy getting a TV show?
Yeah.
Like, the guy who is killed off just before the third act properly starts, the guy who is the designated villain, the guy who, like, murders Rick Flagg, tries to kill Ratcatcher, and then, like, dies so he can cover up the US experimenting on kids. Why is this guy going to be the guy who gets 8 episodes on HBO Max? And then you watch Cena, and, like, I think Gunn has talked about this. Like, the genesis of this was, A, him, like, not having anything to do during lockdown. He was supposed to go on holidays and obviously couldn't. So instead, he wrote 8 episodes of a show that he never thought was going to be produced, which I kind of love. And the other genesis was that, like, working with Cena on set, something clicked with him. And I think, like, Peacemaker is Cena in that, like, you look at Cena's performance. He does that thing that I think Gunn comes back to repeatedly, which is this idea of men who are like emotionally stunted children and who are like still working through the fact that they are emotionally stunted children. And so they have this weird vulnerability to them. And obviously Peter Quill is a great example where he's like a child whose development was literally arrested the day he left Earth because he failed to deal with the death of his mother. Mm-hmm. Like that's his character arc. Gamora, Nebula, you know, they're kind of abused children or whatever, all that sort of stuff. And obviously into Suicide Squad, where every single character has like a trauma involving their parents that froze them in time. And I think what's remarkable about Cena in Peacemaker is that he's really the perfect embodiment of that for Gunn, because he really does seem like he's a 12. He seems like he's Tom Hanks in Big, yes. Except it's Tom Hanks in Super Big, yeah. Where he's a 12-year-old kid who woke up in the body of Arnold Schwarzenegger, which is remarkable.
Yeah, no, and so like I think this is why I kind of started this with my greasy diner explanation, because I do think that fundamentally there are issues, especially in the first couple of episodes. It's a little shaky, but by the time we get to that fourth episode and the story really starts to kick off and the characters start to really kind of like settle into their roles in the narrative, it is really turning into a joyous event. Like the first episode, I mean, listen, I can't sell it harder than like fully nude John Cena climaxing to freedom.
I mean, it gets even better because like then he gets thrown around the room by like a woman like a third of her size who is also in her underwear. Like so much of what's great about the show is that he's this big lumbering dude, and over the course of like the first three episodes, he's repeatedly pummeled by people who are a third his size and often like extremely physically vulnerable. It's phenomenal.
It's beautiful. It's really it's a show that I am very much enjoying overall, despite my personal anti-gun preferences.
And I'm a bit gun shy, as it were.
You know, some of my issues in the first couple of episodes is, and again, personal comedic taste issues, is I don't think Gunn does a very good job of setting a base reality. Obviously, if you're watching this, you have probably already seen The Suicide Squad, in which Bloodshot is our kind of straight man character. Yeah. He's our base reality. But in Peacemaker, everybody's a weirdo right away. And so pinning like the extra weirdo-ness of John Cena on top of that doesn't make a big difference, because everybody's bizarre and weird. And so it's really hard to find the comedic rhythm of this. And it's there, but it's... I wish we would have had at least one character who's like, I am normal guy who is here to be normal. I wish we had more reaction shots of normal people being weirded out by all the weirdos, you know?
Like, I mean, it's worth pointing out, like, the first three episodes set up the idea that maybe Murn is the group straight man, and then the fourth episode's cliffhanger is, oh no, he's an alien.
Yeah.
By the way, I am Team Murn. It's very odd that I identify with the pencil-pushing bureaucrat, but I'm like, yeah, I'm Team Murn here.
But even he, who is, like, you know, kind of the leader, the straight man character, is, like, very open about how weird he is. There's no base reality for which the comedy to jump off of. Once you get four episodes in, I feel like you can make up enough base reality on your own. But again, little comedic issues that I have.
Fair. I mean, I will say that I do like that this seems to take Gunn back to basics. Like, this feels closer to something like, say, Slither, or something like, say, Super, mm-hmm. than it does to, say, The Suicide Squad or Guardians of the Galaxy. And I kind of like that. It does feel like you could see Peacemaker bashing somebody on the head with a wrench for skipping a line.
I mean, that's just the character of Vigilante, right?
No, that's the thing. It's like Peacemaker is the Crimson Bolt and Vigilante is Bolty. Like,
there you go.
It's a thing that Gunn does, which is like, it's the opposite of what you suggested, where like you're suggesting you need a base reality to make everybody else seem like outlandish and insane. Like with Vigilante, you have like this character who is so completely psychotic and insane and will like shoot children like just on the instruction of somebody who I don't think he's ever really met in person before he takes the shot.
Yeah.
And like his function is to make everybody else seem more sane by comparison. So like Gunn kind of goes the opposite direction of what you're suggesting. And I can see that not working for you. And like I do personally, I think my issue with one of my issues with the show is I think Vigilante is a bit out there, and I'm not sure the show knows what it's doing with Vigilante. But I think that he helps focus the rest of the characters and make them seem more plausible as psychologically complex human beings.
Maybe that's it. Maybe that's what helped click it for me, is finally someone so outside of reality, the weird reality became the base. That's fair. That's very fair. I guess we've been kind of ignoring the elephant in the room, which is the show makes it very clear the tone that it's setting during its intro sequence, which I will refuse to skip every single episode, which is a choreographed dance number with the entire cast.
Shot in a school gymnasium using one day of footage, because again, we had no budget for this, which I love. But also even things like the fact that it's thematically relevant as well. Not only is it like great fun and set to 80s hair metal, but you have this kind of juxtaposition of the characters doing their wonderful dance moves. And a shout out, I think, to like Jennifer Holland, I think, is the MVP of the opening credit sequence. But I also love Chukwudi Iwoji, who's an actor who like I know from his work on stage in the UK doing Shakespeare. So it's always fun to see a Shakespearean actor doing hip thrusts. But like the thing is that like they're all doing it with this kind of wonderful deadpan facial expression, which is not only like it's very funny, but thematically it's relevant as well, because this is a show about like the idea that you suppress your feelings and instead need to acknowledge them and work through them and deal with them instead of going through the motions. And I'm like, it's funny, it's visually interesting, and it underscores the themes of the TV show. How can I not love this?
And it just kicks down the door with, this is the kind of show we're making. If you are not on board with that, stop now. If you are into this, welcome to the circus, baby. Though I will say, like, I was born in the 80s, which means that technically I'm a 90s kid. And so, like, all of the hair metal and heavy metal they use, I have no clue whether these are parody hair metal songs or actual hair metal songs. Either way, I'd be very happy.
It's 50-50, it seems. Like, I went through the list myself. A lot of them are, like, Norwegian, Scandinavian. You had, like, tribute to hair metal bands. And then there are some stuff like the Choir Boys, for example, which, and the, you know, and the 11th Street Kids and stuff, which are from the era in question, which I kind of love that Gunn goes to that level of care. And again, the fact that all that is, again, Darren is overthinking it, so I apologize, but the fact that that's all thematically relevant as well, because the whole thing is that, like, Peacemaker is an 80s kid. He's an 80s action hero. He's Stallone and he's Schwarzenegger, so of course he's stuck in this arrested development of loving hair metal. And the whole thing with the show is, like, can you take a Reagan-era action hero, which is, like, traditionally, like, an asshole borderline sociopath who will do whatever it takes for the greater good and, like, patriotism, and can you make him, like, a modern functional human being who understands that feelings are things that are important? And, like, I love that so much.
No, that's beautiful. Well, and, like, even, like, peeling back the onion more, hair metal in of itself is this, like, facade of performance over substance. And it's like, so many layers. No, it's a really wonderful show, and I'm really glad that I watched it. Overall, like I said, I'm still, you know, not 100% on Team Gunn, though I respect him so much as a creator, though we don't always mesh. I think as a director, especially as an actor's director,
yeah,
I think he is able to elevate performances like no other, especially with ensembles. John Cena and James Gunn forever. Anything they make, I will always be there day one. Yeah.
No, I agree entirely. I mean, I think I am warmer than you on it, I guess, from my ecstatic raving. I can see why people don't like it. I can see why that distance exists between it. But I'm also like, this feels like something that was both incredibly fun for everybody who worked on it to make, is incredibly fun for me to watch, and is also kind of engaged with ideas underneath, right? All like the explosions and goo and gore and violence and banter. And I'm like, yeah, this is the sweet spot.
Also, it's an expanded universe show that doesn't constantly bring in characters that we already know. It's new. It's a new story talking about new things. Isn't that exciting? Everyone should be doing that.
Okay, easy, Jack. You're coming through my monitor. And normally that only happens when I get very excited about Peacemaker. But what I was about to say, and I'll go further than that. what I really love about the show is that it's not about the next thing. Mm. Like, it's not about getting me to tune into or go to the cinema to see the Batman, even though that's not set in the universe, or to go and see the Flash, which is set in the universe. It's not about tying all this stuff together. It's like Gunn is like, no, this is just a story I want to tell about this person and this character, and it's probably never going to be referenced again. I can't imagine that Batman is going to talk about how I Peacemaker thinks he's a pussy, or if Superman's poop fetish is going to come up in conversation. But like, you know, I mean, I love that the show is just like, yeah, take me or leave me, watch me or don't. Like, do that on my own merits. Don't do it because it's part of a building block of a larger synergy of, you know, sort of overlapping shows that are designed to suck you in. More of this, please.
More of this. Like, it's just in this little pocket, it makes the world of the DC expanded universe that much bigger. It exists by itself. It can reference other things, but it's just, oh, look at what happens if you turn the camera of the universe just over there for a little bit. We can always turn back.
Like, can we acknowledge that this exists in the same shared continuity as Batman versus Superman?
Yes.
Like all that operatic, like sepia tinted, like woe is me Superman existential stuff, which I quite enjoy, to be clear, coexists with like John Cena yelling in the front garden about why he doesn't have a coterie of supervillains because they're 6 feet under. That's what a shared universe should be. It should be, like, I've talked about this before, it should be the big event book, and it should also be the weird creator-driven odd project that only 12 people read. Like, that's what's great about superhero shared universes.
The tentpole is there for a reason, to hold up all the weird little stuff, and now we got a weird little stuff. Isn't that great?
Yeah.
All right. Now some dorks are going to talk about anime.
I hope they have an animated discussion. Really mangled that transition.
Ooh. Oh, what a tangled weeb we web.
I guess you could say the weebs are in the weeds here. Ooh. No, that's not fair. I don't know enough about anime. I should not be making jokes like that.
Cut away.
Cut away. Quick.
Hello, everybody. Marty Sleva here with Casey Wosu, and welcome to our first ever installment of Weeb Shit.
We did it.
Welcome. Welcome to our inaugural Weeb Shit. This is an anime-focused segment that you all helped fund last year in a streaming funding goal.
Yeah, this is your fault.
Yeah, this is your fault, or this is our gift to you, so thank you so much. Yeah, like I said, Marty and Casey here, we're going to have pairs of us coming on every once in a while to talk about the latest and greatest in anime, and we wanted to kick this one off with what is currently the biggest thing in anime right now, which is the final season of Attack on Titan. So I guess we're finally in the back half of the final season. This has been one of the, I think, the biggest, like, culturally, sort of one of the biggest anime of the past decade or so, and it's finally wrapping up now. Casey, what is your history with Attack on Titan?
Well, I'm in a bunch of, I bounce around a bunch of, like, anime Facebook groups, even though I don't like to consider myself the biggest anime fan in the world, though behind me clearly speaks differently. but, like, a lot of people were kind of talking about it, especially like when it was in manga form, like folks will be like, oh, this is going to be the next big thing. Right. Mm-hmm. So when it did get its premiere, I decided to check it out because of just all the word of mouth. And the first couple episodes blew me away. I, at the time, hadn't really seen anything in MAPPA's now iconic style, like those heavy, dark lines, like super fluid movement, just really high quality animation. And then just the tone of the opening episodes and like that big, I guess I still won't spoil it in case you haven't seen it at all, but like some stuff happens in like those first couple episodes that just break you in a way where you're like, you weren't expecting it. And it just so happened that was the number of episodes that were available at the time. So I jumped straight to the manga after that and just read everything that existed in Attack on Titan until there was no more. And then at that point, I had waited all the way clear through like up to season 3.
Okay.
And then finally went back and started watching everything just so it would be long enough for me to like enjoy the stuff that I already knew was going to happen in the anime. But honestly, I probably didn't even need to wait that long because the animation just adds so much extra to that show. Like, it is gorgeous and incredible, and I've been loving it. And I'm so happy that it's finally coming to a close, not because it's bad, but because like we're getting answers to like a bunch of stuff that we started out questioning.
Yeah, and sometimes it's nice to have the things we love eventually come to an end. Not like people, I don't want people to die. Like, no one wants their loved ones to die, but like sometimes it's nice when something sets a finish line and you're like, oh, okay, this thing's gonna have an ending.
Except for One Piece.
Except for One Piece. It'll never end. They'll never find that treasure. They'll find like Two Piece, right? I don't know. Is that how that works?
It'll be a swimsuit at the end of the Grand Line. We're like, what is this?
But yeah, we'll keep it spoiler free for the beginning part. And then at the end of the convo, we'll sort of be able to dig more into the meat and potatoes. But so you've been a fan a very long time. I literally watched my first episode 3 weeks ago, and in that time I have watched everything and I'm totally caught up.
Damn.
And it's kind of like a whirlwind. It's probably not a good way to like enjoy things or consume things.
I don't know. I tend to think that just consuming in a massive lump of just content is perfectly fine. It's healthy for your brain in probably some ways. I've done no research on this though.
I'm curious if like it'll stick with me, because I feel like if something's week to week, I end up like thinking about it all week and like really like digesting the episodes. Whereas with this, it's just like I jumped into the deep end and watched 75 episodes in 3 weeks. And I'm glad I did, because this would be, I feel like the show would be really hard to watch week to week because there are so many cliffhangers where I'm like, I can't believe people had to wait years after this. Like after, like at the end of a season, sometimes it was years before the next one.
It's been a while.
Yeah, absolutely. But yeah, I agree with you. The characters right off the bat are incredibly likable, and the cast just grows and grows. Like I compare it a couple times in my mind to Game of Thrones in the way that there are so many moving pieces, and all of those pieces end up being fleshed out.
Yeah.
And so much stuff that happens in the first season ends up being, there's a real payoff as you go later on. Like so many breadcrumbs were dropped, not only in the first season, in the first episode, that end up becoming important things in season 3 and even into season 4, that maybe that's one of the good things about binging it, is all that stuff was so fresh in my head. And I'm like, oh, when they go back to the basement, I'm like, holy moly, like, I can't believe they went back to this place they've been talking about since season 1.
Yeah, I really liked the pacing of that in a way, because what they did is like they gave you like this very enigmatic goal and made it really hard for the characters to achieve it. And once they finally do, that payoff gives you a ton more questions. That can sometimes be frustrating, but because, like you said, the characters are likable and the situation that they're in is kind of unique. Like, it's zombie-like in that they're mindless creatures that want to eat humans.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
Like, it is a twist on it. And, like, that information that you get when you get to the basement turns that entire scenario on its head. And, like, so you do want to, you know, keep learning more after that point. So it keeps its momentum in that way.
Yeah, and it almost goes like the show, we're going to start veering into more spoiler territory, but to keep it still general, the show almost feels like it changes genres as it morphs. Like it almost feels like horror, like you mentioned zombies, like horror when it starts, because there's these titans and they're just ugly as hell and they're just monstrous. And that is one of my sticking points, is like sometimes the titans just look dumb and like on purpose. Like they move dumb.
They make them look really silly.
Yeah. And like the core, like the when there's like a major titan, you're always like, oh, that's pretty cool looking. But then you just see all these dumb ones. You're like, what's going on here? Like, I want a reason why they look dumb. Like, there's got to be a reason.
Yeah, like, it's probably like, oh, it's like a moment of levity. Because like you were saying, it is, especially at the outset, a horror show. Like, it is scary what's happening to these characters. And like, it is very gruesome as well. Like, I'm not a fan of like gory, violent stuff. But like in this show, it's used to good effect. Like it really sells how dire the situation is, and you're on board with everyone's fear and motivation. Because like a lot of people will be like, oh, this main character is weak because he's afraid. Have you seen what they're up against?
Yeah, I would be afraid too. Yeah. Yeah, and the show does a really good job too of, you know, having certain characters like members of the military, they'll put on like a really brave front, but when push comes to shove and they actually come face to face with some of these things, they are like mortified because they're like, oh, we prepared for this, but like none of us have ever seen these things, and they're described as devils, and when you see them, you understand like why people are so mortified. But the thing is, once the show starts unraveling and you learn what they actually are, it adds just a completely new layer to the entire thing. And you view the entire thing through a completely different lens. And while it's still like the ODM gear itself is still just like an extremely cool, like everything about that is cool. Like the movement is cool. It's this like awesome combination of like ninjas and Spider-Man and technology juxtaposed with sort of this like old, like medieval German architecture of everything. And it just, the ODM stuff, I think just at its core, yeah, is really cool.
It's steampunk as hell.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. But as you move on, and especially like you said, once you get to that sort of turn at the end of season three, and this is where we'll bring in some of the spoilers of up to the third episode of this final season where we are, and you realize that it's not like the people on this island are alone in the world. Like this is ultimately, it's kind of like a historical penal colony in that there's just the rest of the world going on as usual, and the rest of the world views the people of Paradis, like the main characters for the first three seasons, as the enemy. And so season four, as it opens with, you know, several episodes on the Marley mainland with characters either we haven't seen before or characters who were straight up villains that are now our sort of point of view and protagonist characters, it completely shifted the way I thought about this show.
And that's tough to do. Like, you spend that much time with characters who are likable and cool, and then you then have to leave them for an extended period of time to talk about the bad guys, right? Like, or to go like real far in the path, because it does that also. Like, it gives you like a lengthy origin story for some other characters, right? And like, they spend a ton of time fleshing out the enemy, and you do at the end of that come to understand where they're coming from. Like, characters on that side end up being likable. Characters on that side have motivations that you can get behind, and suddenly everything is a lot more muddy and gray. And though you're maybe rooting for like a particular character that you like, it doesn't necessarily feel as cathartic. Like, I'll specifically mention like kind of the ongoing rivalry between Zeke, who is the Beast Titan, and Levi. Like, how,
yeah,
like they really want to kill each other. Like, they have so much deep-seated hatred, but they're kind of working together because they also have a common enemy. The tension for that is real, and it's palpable because you know both sides of their stories. Like, you get why they both need to win.
Exactly.
It's good that a show is willing to do that. Like, they spent the time on the enemy to make them fully 3D characters.
100%. And that's like, yeah, the Beast Titan, you know, you when you don't know anything about him, you just hate him. He's just the antagonist.
Yeah, he's just really scary, and you want, yeah.
And he does that sort of silly, like, baseball throw thing, and you're like, that's weird. And then you, like, go into his past, and you realize, like, his only happy moments as a child was when he got to have a catch with, like, his surrogate father. And like, that is sort of where like the root of the baseball thing comes from. And I'm like, oh, okay, well, I didn't expect to feel that way. And you even get the same thing with like Reiner, the armored titan. You know, Reiner is just a villain. And then once you get his backstory, you're like, oh no, I don't want this. I don't think I want this character to die. Like, this character has gone through so much. And like, I understand where he's coming from in this whole conflict. And that sort of brings you to the present where, you know, we have Aaron, who after, he was our main character, and then after season three, there's a time jump, and Aaron's kind of become this, like, messiah terrorist figure, and, like, you don't know, like, the Anime Awards has him nominated as Best Protagonist and Best Antagonist, and I'm like, yeah, I kind of understand that.
Yeah, Aaron has committed some war crimes.
Yeah, he's committed a lot of war crimes. The same thing with, like, Armin. Anytime he transforms into the Colossal Titan, I'm like, ooh, a nuke just went off. You killed lots of people. That is not great.
Like, they've done this from season one, like, the dark outlines and the dark lines on everyone's face. Like, the kids didn't necessarily have them so much when they were kids, but all of like the older soldiers, especially like their commander who trained them, you can see every time they do a close up, there's just shadows all over like their eyes. And all of the characters now that they're adults have those shadows in their eyes. And it's just like the toll of the stuff that they've seen. Like, it's just drawn right on their face. Like, they look weary from all of that killing, all of that death.
Yeah. And you get this, sense that like in war, there are no heroes. There's just survivors. And you have characters like that Captain Ervin, who just at the end of the day just wanted to be over with it, like just right. kind of like he embraced death because he was like, I just am so tired of this. And it's yeah, like really like surprisingly emotional. And I'm really I'm looking forward. I know there's manga readers, so the manga's finished.
Yeah, the manga has come to a close.
Did you finish the manga reading it?
No, I did. It's rare that I actually read manga. Like, this was kind of an outlier that I went and read the manga for Attack on Titan, but that was years ago. It was when the show first aired, so I read all that was available then, and then I took a break.
Yeah. And it seems like folks who've gone ahead and finished the manga, it seems like there's almost like a Game of Thrones-y vibe to it in that a lot of people aren't super thrilled with the ending. But for me, it's more of like the journey so far has been great.
If anything, in this like this home stretch, I will say I'm not necessarily a fan of Zeke's goal, like this whole euthanization plan.
Yeah.
Like, I get his motivations why he would want to do something, you know, to liberate his people, but like the thing he's choosing to do,
yeah,
that's like saying like, okay, so the world hates us, what we're gonna do is make sure all of us die so that the world can be fine and we're out of the picture. Like, that's just a weird conclusion to come to.
Yeah, it's ultimately like sterilizing an entire race to be like, well, if they can't reproduce, then in the next generation we'll be fine because there'll be no more, which is just kind of an awful thought.
It's a weird conclusion to come to. And clearly the wrong one, which, you know, it kind of undoes a little bit of the characterization of, you know, rooting for that side. So like, it turns it into just a bad idea for bad people a little bit. So I can see, like, if it keeps going down that road, I can see why maybe there's some disappointment, but I don't know how it actually ends yet. But we'll see.
Yeah, and I'm imagining we're still going to get, like, Eren has something up his sleeves. In this most recent episode, it's clear that he wasn't on board with Zeke's plan. So I feel like we're going to get an episode where we really dig into, like, okay, what has been going on in Eren's head over the last 4 years? Because, like, I don't think he just turned into a baddie. Like, I think this is all part of some plan. And, like, the awful shit he says to, like, Armin and Mikasa, I think he said that on purpose. He didn't say that to try to hurt them. I think there's some deeper meaning to that.
Like, he needed to push them away so that he could go do the thing that he wants to do and save everybody. He wants to put all the weight on his shoulders, like most protagonists tend to try and do.
It's exciting, though, and I'm excited that we're in this final stretch. I don't know if there's another 12, 15 episodes in this back half of the season, but yeah, we'll see. Maybe we'll come back once it's all wrapped up and have another conversation about it. But before we go with our inaugural Weeb Shit discussion, I figure we can end these segments by giving folks a recommendation of maybe something in anime to check out or a manga to read. Do you have anything for the folks?
I don't know. The folks who are probably way into this show probably know everything that I would suggest, like especially like new stuff, because I tend to catch up after the fact. But if you haven't started already, watch That Time I Got Reincarnated as a Slime. It's dumb in terms of like you can tell because of the title, but like it's really wholesome in a way. Like you see a character who only wants to do good, succeed at doing good and bringing people together while also being like really strong and having really strong friends and having like awesome fights. So it's a kind of a feel good thing that is a nice palate cleanser for how dark Attack on Titan can get, because that show can get real real dour.
I mean, I have a feeling I'm gonna need a feel good thing after it.
How about you? You have anything you want to suggest?
Yeah, my suggestion also very different than Attack on Titan. It's not like this shouldn't be like an IMDb. Ooh, you like this? We'll recommend this.
Right.
I've talked about it on a few things, but my favorite show of last year, of any show, anime or non-anime, was Odd Taxi on Crunchyroll, and it's I believe 13 episodes. And it's about a 40-year-old cab driver in Tokyo who's like just sort of over it, and it's about him and the passengers he picks up, and those are, you know, range from sort of these a trio of idols to a nurse and a doctor to his sort of alcoholic best friend to a wannabe gangster. But the thing is, the main character Arakawa, the cab driver, is a walrus, and every character is an animal. But it's just regular Tokyo. The animal part is sort of like a weird hump to get past, but once you do, it's one of the most interesting sort of urban spaghetti tangled crime stories I've seen in any medium. Like, it has comparisons to like Paul Thomas Anderson movies and Quentin Tarantino movies, and I think those are absolutely spot on. Like, it's such a smart and tight story of all these different characters and how their lives intersect. And ultimately you're like, oh, everyone is connected by these things. And just the way all the pieces fall together at the end are absolutely fantastic. It also has one of the greatest opening songs ever. It's one of those things where it's like, it's a no skip. We talk about those sometimes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just check out the opening even. The opening's absolutely a no skip. So,
I mean, speaking of openings, like I know it changed recently, but the opening and ending credits music for this fourth season have been awesome. Like, oh my God. Like,
they were really good. Yeah.
Yeah. They were really good. Like of probably some four. Of the best. Yeah. Yeah. Probably some of the best Attack on Titan intros and outros that have existed.
Completely agree. And we'll see how if we settle into the metal, because as of right now, I have not.
Yeah, that one is kind of a skipper.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Casey, thank you so much once again. My name is Marty. This is our inaugural episode of Weeb Shit. And also, if you liked that Weeb Shit intro, which God knows we did, thank Omar for that. So Omar, thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right. Bye, everybody.